Joining me now in the Sydney studio from L2 Capital Partners is Marcelo Lopez to discuss uranium. Marcelo, welcome. We have seen uranium go from quite a bear market to really rather a bullish one lately. Talk to us about this change.
Sure. Well, thanks for having me, Danielle. It's a pleasure to be here. Yeah, uranium was, to me, probably the most unloved commodity of them all. So we saw in the last 10 years, all the commodities doing relatively well, and uranium did really poorly. But since the end of 2017, this scenario has changed, and uranium is now up by 40% since the lows of last year. So yeah, I think the market is catching up on the story. It's a very easy call, uranium. It's a demand and supply story. Demand's been increasing, supply has been decreasing, and the commodity's been trading, even though it's been up all this time, it's still half the cost of production. So there's no way for the commodity to go, in my opinion, but up from here.
Let's talk a bit about legislation surrounding uranium. What's the latest here in Australia? Do you expect any changes, especially with those elections coming up? And what about the US? That Section 232 move looks to be quite positive for uranium.
Sure. Well, the sentiment towards uranium, as I said, it's not very good. So even though it provides clean energy, cheap energy, and reliable, safe energy, still people have a bit of a difficult time accepting uranium into their lives. In the US, it's 20% of the base load production in the US comes from uranium. So it's a very important market for them. France is over 70%. China, which is a growth story, is just under 5%, but they want to take it all the way up to 20%. Russia is just over 20%. So I think legislation is catching up to the story. And in the US, the big news is Section 232, which is pretty much an investigation carried out by the Department of Commerce after two uranium producers early last year asked for this petition. And basically what they are asking is for the Department of Commerce to investigate the uranium market in the US, how it's being played out. So as a matter of national security, as a matter of unfair trading, the Department of Commerce actually accepted this petition and started investigation in mid last year. Now, on the 12th of April this year, they're going to come up with a recommendation, and then President Trump has another 90 days to take to make a decision on it. And that's where we're going to see the real action happening in the uranium market, in my opinion.
What other macro factors are having an effect on uranium markets? Things like electric vehicles, the proliferation of battery storage. Do these present opportunities or threats, or are they irrelevant?
No, they present a big opportunity for the market because electric vehicles pollute way less than the diesel or gasoline run vehicles. So it doesn't make sense to me that you have an electric vehicle and then recharge the battery using electricity produced with mineral coal, for instance, that pollutes a lot. So there's got to be a clean policy towards the sector, and I think uranium provides just that. It's cheap, abundant, and very reliable source of clean energy.
Let's walk through those critical aspects of supply, demand, and price, shall we? Let's start with supply. What's happening on the landscape there?
Sure. Actually, what brought my attention into the sector was an announcement from Cameco in late 2017. In which they say that they will put the biggest and the richest mine in the world, which is MacArthur River, in care and maintenance, starting in January last year until October. And I thought, wow, for Cameco to put these mines into care and maintenance, who can actually produce uranium? Because the price is really, really low. Soon after, Kazatomprom announced a 20% cut in production too. Last year, Paladin put its mine, Langerheinrich, into care and maintenance as well. And then in July, Cameco came to the market and said that they would put MacArthur River in care and maintenance indefinitely. So they unfortunately have to sack 500 people, and the mine is just not producing anymore. So it's 15, 16 million pounds of uranium that's not going to hit the market. And Cameco not only stopped producing, but then it's active in the market buying. So it tilted the scale pretty much in favor of the bullish sentiment towards uranium. And last year, and I'm sure we're going to talk about the demand, but last year we saw the emergence of a new buyer, which are the financial buyers. So funds like Yellow Cake that were listed in London last year that raised $200 million approximately and use it to buy 8.1 million pounds of uranium. So it's 8.1 million pounds of uranium that's not going to hit the market, definitely not at these levels. So we're seeing people more conscious now about the pricing. And according to the International Energy Agency, the average mine spends around $60 a pound to produce uranium and is selling for less than 30. So every single mine has a, well, according to them, the average mine has a loss on each pound of uranium they're producing. So they just are not incentivized enough to produce any uranium. So as soon as the contracts, the long-term contracts are coming to an end, they're just stopping producing, putting the mines into care and maintenance or shutting down overall.
And meanwhile, what is happening on the development front?
Sure, well, the demand has never been stronger. Today, there's just over 450 reactors producing energy throughout the world, 50 being built at this moment, 13 will be delivered this year, another 13 next year. So the demand has never been higher. And there's over 500 reactors being planned and proposed. Besides, Japan has restarted 9 of its reactors. There's another 17 that has applied for a restart. So the demand is doing really, really well. Demand actually last year outstripped supply. So last year, the demand, not accounting for the financial buyers, was around 180 million pounds of uranium, and the production was just under 140 million pounds of uranium. So last year was the first year in 10 that we saw a deficit in this market. And this deficit is going to be bigger this year. And unless uranium prices go up big time, we're going to see the supply diminishing even more.
Well, Marcelo, it sounds like you're pretty clear that prices will continue to go up. Can you give us a bit of an idea about the proportion you expect it to grow, the timeline, the length of time you expect it to keep growing for?
Sure. Well, it's very difficult to predict this kind of stuff. I do believe the price have to go up to a level that incentivizes mines to produce again and new mines to be discovered and prepared, because the uranium cycle is a very long cycle. It's not like coal that you produce today and 3, 5, 10 days after you're delivering it to the blast furnace. Uranium takes a year and a half to 2 years to be pretty much for them to leave the mine and get to the nuclear reactors. They have to be transformed into a gas. They have to be enriched. They have to be fabricated into the fuel rods. So it's a long, long process. And so if a reactor needs uranium in 2021, it's already late to contract now. And we see inventories coming down in the last few years. There's a year and a bit that utilities haven't contracted. So it's a year and a bit, probably a year and a half by the time of the decision that, from Section 232, that inventories will be down. So we see no other way for it to go but up and big time. Now, how much it will go up and when, I believe it will start to go up after Trump's decision, because it would then clear the way, it would take the elephant out of the room so people can sit down at the table and decide contracts again. And how much, it's anyone's guess. But I do believe we're going to see uranium much higher than what it is now.
Of course, due to the nature of uranium, it is a bit of a special commodity in the way that it's moved around, it's traded. You do have to have contracts in place. And there have been a lot of changes on the market front. You mentioned the listing of Yellow Cake last year. There were a few others around the world. What do you think investors need to know about getting into uranium, those who aren't really aware of how it works? Sure. Standing out from the rest of those more typical commodities?
Sure. Well, the contracts, uranium doesn't have a very clear price mechanism like the other commodities. So it's a bit opaque, to say the least. Contracts sometimes are disclosed, sometimes are not, and they are negotiated privately. And it's difficult for us to get access to all of those. So we have an idea of where it's going. and they have to go up for the reasons I mentioned here. But each mine has its different, its particular particularities. So each mine has a different price that they would settle and start producing and delivering this uranium. I still believe we are in the very early stages of a long-term bull market for the commodity.
Looking globally, which geographies do you think are most attractive for uranium players? And here in Australia, are there any companies you like?
Sure. Well, because of Section 232, I think the US is a great place to be. US friendly markets like Australia and Canada and Namibia are also great places to be. And in terms of Australia, I like a couple of companies here. I like Boss Resources. I like Bannerman. I think they're doing well. And I think they can benefit a lot from the coming bull market.
Marcelo Lopez, thank you very much for the insights.
My pleasure.